Hello, good afternoon, and welcome for joining this live stream on yet another program, the second one in a series of two. My name is Rudy, and I will be the sidekick yet again with this exclusive conversation between Carlo van der Weijer and Hans de Benning. I'm going to explain you a little bit more about this, but first and foremost, we've got several groups joining right now, some exclusive startup teams actually. They are active in the field of mobility, and they've got the unique opportunity to also interact with us here in this studio. And we're coming to you from the University of Technology in Eindhoven. And next to that, there will be also people participating through YouTube in the live stream, or maybe you're watching this later on. A warm welcome to all of you as well. And when you're watching the live stream right now on this April 13th, it's possible to hand in some questions as well in the feed. So feel free to do so. As I said before, this is an exclusive boost program offered to these several startups here in the Western Europe region. And it's made possible by the EIT and then the Hub of Western Europe. And this second one will be zooming in on the startup scale-up company of Amber Mobility. Maybe whenever you visited the region of Eindhoven, you've seen them driving around small little electric cars, white and orange. And CEO Hans de Benning is here to go into conversation with Carlo van der Weijer. And Carlo was here last time as well when we spoke with Lightyear. Carlo, attached to the University of Technology, a TUE fellow. Actually, you're an expert on the topic of mobility. You like all kinds of mobility, some maybe more than others. And we can ask you some questions as well, but mainly in the focus today is Hans de Benning. And Carlo, I'm curious what questions you have for Hans yourself and whether you've been the GDC yourself. That's by your own words. Last time you said I used to be the chief diapers change officer.
Yeah, I
of some of the startups who were founded here at the University of Technology, but actually evolved into real companies. Some sort of a spin-off what Lightyear did as well, and maybe Amber Mobility find its roots here at University.
Yes, they did. It's always nice to be introduced as the chief diaper change officer of the Technical University student teams. But actually, I luckily also changed some of your diapers back then, yeah. Because Hans is indeed also one of the former student team members. Built some very nice ecological vehicles back then in the older, but that's already quite some years ago. So I'm so happy to every now and then still meet you, and a little bit proud whenever I see one of these white shared electric vehicles with this very typical orange striping on it. That's it. So that's Amber Mobility, and we'll tell more about Amber Mobility in a second. But indeed, welcome again. This program, this boost program, is actually a program to boost startups with a lot of lessons learned for startups, but mainly from startups. So I also liked the former version quite well, the first episode out of four. This is the second one. I like it especially because it teached me more than I ever teach these student teams. Today, we're going to focus on the financial business case and the public-private investment, something, of course, a very hot topic for startups. Last time, we talked about the organization and strategic partnerships. There's a lot of lessons learned there as well. So if you haven't seen the first edition, then please take a look back. They're still available on YouTube. But today, a little bit more on the financials, which of course give startup a little bit more headache even. So welcome, Hans. Sorry,
thank you.
We didn't hear about you, but how's life at Amber, maybe as a first question?
Yeah, it was a rough year. That's
can imagine.
I can confirm, especially when you're in the mobility. Because one of the things that changed last year, then it is mobility.
Yeah.
We were focused on business users, so people that use the cars for their business trips, and they basically disappeared. We catched up with consumers, and that's what we did last year. So we learned a lot and worked on a lot of new interesting products and propositions for our customers.
Okay, so new products. I know the product as being just to. And please try it because it's so very easy to try.
Just download the app.
Download the app and you can just hire an electric vehicle wherever you are and leave it somewhere else wherever you go. And so that's actually the sharing. But you have guaranteed access, huh? Because that's what I always object to a big future of sharing cars. That's what we discussed in the beginning. That for some, when you go from your own car to a shared car, you lose the guaranteed access to a car.
Yeah.
But you found some interesting things on how to solve that.
Actually, that's the topic that I can confirm that your title is right, because we based our business, current business model on a study that was done with the university, and we had a presentation about it. And what we found out was that the most important hassle for people to not use a shared car is that they have the chance that they don't have one, that it is not always available. And if you don't have the guarantee that you can use the car, then you will use your own car and you will never use the shared car anymore. And then you will stuck with your own car. And that's something that needs to be changed. And that's where we work on. And what we do, when you make a reservation in the app, then we will guarantee that the car is available for you within an hour and it's standing there in front of you and you can use it whenever you want.
Yeah, guaranteed access, that's the thing. So people get experience it, and we're not going too much of an advertisement here, but it's always good to any mobility solution that's new. They're so easy to test every of them, so please also give them a chance. I can guarantee you'll be satisfied with that one. So, you said Corona is, of course, not really helping you because you're especially in the business model of the business mobility. But you said private mobility is growing in the meantime. So if the business comes back, the future might look bright.
Yeah, there are a lot of people that are now switching from public transport to individual transport. So they just get out of the train. That's on the one half. On the other hand, there's a lot of people that don't use the car not as often anymore. So they want to get rid of the car because it's standing still all the time. But sometimes they need a car. And then they look for another solution. And that's something that we anticipate.
Okay. So just to start with the product of the topic of today, which is finance, and think that that's, of course, when you ask a startup, it's the main worry. How and maybe also the question, how do you start without any money? Because that's how any startup starts.
Yeah.
How did you start?
Yeah, you start just with an idea. that's basically what you do. So you don't have any legacy, you don't have any money to put in. So especially when you start as a student, as we did, during our studies, we came up with the idea of Amber. And then you just start without spending any money. So what we did, we just worked out some ideas, do some testing, ask companies if we can test at their site, if we can use their facilities to test, if we can deliver something to a customer that doesn't cost our money. So in basically that they start with some consultancy or some testing or some proof concept, but not spend money on it. That's what you do in the beginning. And but after a while you have to you spend your first euro.
And you need to eat.
And you need to eat, yes. And so also your pizza money is needed. So you want to have the pizza and the drinks to have more ideas and to work on it in the late evenings. For us it was where the friends and families came in, and we call them friends, families and fools. That's how they call it in the startup scene.
That's your financial source in the beginning.
That's your financial source.
The triple F.
Yes. Yes, and they believe in you as a person, in the first steps, in the ideas that you have, but not in something that you have proven or something that you have done in the past. And that's difficult for larger investors, especially for banks or for investors, to invest in something that doesn't have anything in the past. So you stuck with the people that believe in you, so that's your friends and families, but also people that believe in the ideas and think, it might work, and they start investing a few bucks into the company.
And what was in the beginning, because you say you have to have a clear idea, without proving that you ever, although you have built a vehicle, had the eco,
at the university.
So you already showed that you could build something, but nevertheless, you had to start with an idea.
Yeah.
That idea was a little bit different than what Amr is currently about, I guess.
Yeah.
Which is also typical. Also, last time we had Lightyear, they had total different ideas than what came out in the end.
Yeah.
What was your idea in the beginning?
Yeah, we started off with designing a car that is built to be to last, to be used for a long period of time, because the current cars are here to break, so they will
20 years lifetime.
Yeah, exactly. And also the car companies will earn more money when the car is broken, because they can repair parts.
Yep.
And we thought if you don't have cars that wear anymore that much anymore, then you can use them for a longer period of time, more intensively, and then you can make cars that are used all day and not only 1 hour a day.
This is something you hear this, and this is with the goal of sharing, because with sharing you want to have cars that last longer, are easy to fix.
Yeah, so that basically, because we think that cars in 20 or 30 years won't be sold anymore at a dealership, and they will be used, because especially in cities we don't have the space to park the cars anywhere, but also because the users don't have the need for a car anymore. It's just they want to have mobility and not owning a car.
That's the basic ground, so you think. And parking will be extremely expensive, so you better share one parking place with 9 people.
That's
huge cost. If you would really ask the price for parking, that's what you talk about. Okay.
Yeah.
So that's the goal. They will share it. And shared stuff has quality, pays off when you share stuff, because you last longer, it's used more often.
Yeah.
So you start with actually, because I do remember the quite nice prototype, at least the
Also white with orange.
It looked very cool, your first Amr. I don't know if we have a picture of that one.
No, I'm not sure.
There's you can find it, the prototype of Amr in the
Ember
beginning.
One.
the Ember One.
Yeah.
You wanted to produce that car and then start sharing it. So that was the complete idea.
Yeah, and
then what happens? Yeah.
Yeah, we knew in the beginning that when we're going to build a car, it will take years to build one, to design one, to test it, and just bring it into the market. And then we thought, okay, but the market will be changed when we arrive there. So that's the reason why we built the car designed the car in another way. Yeah. But when we were designing that car and working on it, we thought, okay, but why don't we try the market right now? Why don't we try our business model?
For the sharing model, we can already test on existing cars and then build the car in parallel.
So we found a car that looks like a prototype, and it was the BMW i3, and it was good enough for the system then. And I thought, okay, let's try our business model with existing cars and not with the cars that will be made and will be delivered in the future. So that's
You're still trying your business model on existing cars, or you're a few steps ahead, actually. You still dream of building a car?
Of course, dreaming of it, but we're currently not working on it. If we grow bigger and we can make it also economically more attractive to work with an old car and not with with an sold car, yes, of course it will be better. But
and the idea is on ice for the moment. Yeah,
exactly.
Maybe the important question in this one is, because it's also what we talked with Lightyear with Tom Selt last time, is that you have to have this big, hairy, audacious goal. You know.
Yeah.
What was this also? Otherwise, would you have been Amber as it is at this moment if you would not have started with this dream that may be a little bit too far ahead?
No, definitely not. Because when we started, it was just we want to have a car that can replace the car that people own. And that was the end goal. So we're working towards that end goal. And if we started with, we want to make a sharing company, then we were competing with the other sharing companies, and we are just one of the guys.
But now
we're working on a bigger goal, and that's the only way to be ahead of the market. That's definitely what...
And that's how you differentiate it from the other ones. This is an interesting one, a lesson that we could park already. That is, I think, Michael Müller, you know, the guy from Picnic, he called this the ABC method. So just go for this ridiculous idea and keep on running, because you go from A to B, but suddenly you will find C on the route that you otherwise would have never found.
Yeah.
And that's actually what happened with you, and you used it
also
to generate.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Another lesson there. Okay, so we start with the friends and family and fools that give you a little bit money and to keep you
alive.
Give you food every now and then. And I've been to you. You try to find a free space which you had in the middle of, not free, but a cheap spot in the middle of the high-tech campus where you started with piles of pizza boxes, etc., which was the highest cost, with a lot of people working there almost for free because their parents still paid their room. They just want to be part of this adventure. That's the energy how you create it. But then you come to the next phase after the triple F. Mm-hmm. Then you need the serious money, etc. What was this next phase?
Yeah, what happened with us that we got our first launching customer, and that was a big bank in the Netherlands, the ABN AMRO bank, and they asked us if we can help them to make their mobility more environmental friendly and also more flexible, and do you have a solution for that? But we didn't have a car at that moment. We just had some ideas, some cool software and some PowerPoints, but that was all. But they saw what we are doing and said, okay, but you think about mobility in a totally different way than all the people that we are talking about, like leasing companies to solve a problem. Can you solve a problem? And we said, yes, of course we can do that. But we didn't have any cars, we didn't have an app. So then everything started off, actually. So we tried to sign a contract, but we needed the leasing company to also sign a contract with us, but we have no financial history, so that was not possible. So then we had to arrange something with all the parties together to get our first contract done. And then everything went quickly, because then you have your first customer, then other customers see, okay, they are doing it, oh, it might work, and then things get bigger.
So actually, ABN AMRO, you owe them a lot in order for you to build the trust in you and started it up. And I know they were happy at a certain point because they could replace
still
a lot
happy,
of
still happy
they're still happy. They're still a customer. That's a sign because they could replace actually a lot of their business cars for a contract with you.
Yeah. So we have an actual solution for them. So we really solve a problem for them.
And as asset base is sort of very positive, and banks know everything about that one. So do we get some questions in?
Definitely. One is very on topic from this first step from the triple F towards where you're talking about right now. So Robert is asking, how valuable has coaching and advice from nearby trusted friends or colleagues been in the development of Amber and the fundraising? So did you also use the triple F not merely just for the money, but did they
advice.
Also give them advice?
Yeah. Yeah, yes, because in the beginning we were just students and we know everything about technology for cars because we're automotive students, but not in running a business or making a financial model. These were the things that we are not good at. And actually, two of our co-founders were former business guys that joined the company to help us. And it was very intense advice at the moment, because they're joining the company and going to work together with you, and that's very valuable for especially when you're just starting a company
to get their perspective right into the company.
I can also I can remember that in the beginning I also introduced you on your request to some leasing companies and some financial companies, etc. And it was never a hassle or a burden to these companies to invest a little bit of time in you, because they were kind of refreshed by your fresh view on the world and that their business might change quite rapidly. So for them, it's also a fitness exercise in order to talk to you. Yep. So you should, as a startup, also not be too hesitant in order to step towards bigger companies, because you can help them as well by giving them a little bit refreshment course.
Yeah, that's something that I see a lot, that small companies are a little bit threatened by larger companies. Yeah. I can't tell my idea to them because they will steal it. But in the end, they are too big to change. And that means that when you when you tell your product, your idea, they don't have the time and the speed to actually do it.
So you don't have to fear them so much.
No, you don't have to fear them, no. Because you can inspire them, you can help them, you can use their experience to make your business better. But in the end, they are most of the time not able to reproduce it themselves. And that is,
So don't fear big companies, but can they also help by investing?
Yes, but
it's not the typical ones.
No, and that's also because they are of their speed, because their decision making took a lot of time, and that's slowing down your company. So never
which, by the way, is not an insult. That's just if you will be as big as they are, then probably also
it's the same problem. Yeah, of course.
So it's not a personal insult, but no. You can. Okay, so
but this is very important for when you're starting a company. Don't wait for the larger companies to do something with you. You have to decide your own speed and not wait for them till they invest or deliver something to you. Decide your own.
So you started actually with we come now to the business case that you had to also confront your investors with, because you raised money at a certain moment, huh? Yep. Quite a bit.
Yeah.
So you're doing well. You will survive the corona pandemic, etc.
Yeah.
So it looks good, but you got investment.
Yep.
This was based on a business plan. You around that time you said, okay, I don't need a couple of billion to build a car. We leave that. We're going to have the app and the sharing.
That makes things easier.
On the other hand, maybe to just grab back on that, you said we had this big idea in order to differentiate from other shared cars.
Yeah.
If you let that go, how did you still differentiate from other sharing models and sharing incentives? Because there are a lot of sharing companies.
Yeah.
How did you still differentiate?
Yeah, that is because the whole team is still working towards that goal to replace car ownership. It is.
But aren't the other ones as well?
In a different way, because they have the legacy, they have another starting point, and we still have the end point, the end goal of mm-hmm. where we start off with, and that's something defines the decision that you make every day. All the decision that you make is towards that goal and towards that way too big goal. That's something that everybody thinks you can never achieve that, but that's the goal that you're still working to.
Maybe also to have a lesson from the last time, what Tom Selter said is that you also need the goal to hire the right people, maybe as a sidestep. Do you also use that, and is it easy to get the good people towards you, because you probably will not pay as much as Shell or who have you, or bigger companies?
No, but money is not a good incentive for good people. If you attract people by money, then you probably have the wrong people in your company. But it needs to be fair. It needs to be.
You have to survive.
Yes, of course. But the best people that you can hire are not always the most expensive one. They're worth it, but not always the most expensive one. When you raise money and you have a larger investor, first invest it in people. That's the most important thing. Invest in good people tracking to the company. And
what else could you invest in? You needed your cars, but that's on lease. That's probably not on your balance. Huh? The cars are not in your balance, I guess.
No, but you can also do a lot of external things and just hire people that not work for the company, but for third parties. You can spend it on a new office. You can spend it on a lot of marketing. You can spend it on a lot of things, but first.
Having said that, you have a very nice office in Strijd T.
That's true.
Not too fancy, of course, but it's it's a very very hot spot.
This is how you present it. That's a very important thing. Yeah,
really.
Yes, definitely. There are some questions also coming in from YouTube, so very much thank you for that. Tamur's got actually a few ones, and one is in line with what you're talking about right now. The solution, he is saying, of Amber becomes profitable only based on scalability. What are the profit percentages, or is even Amber profitable right now?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's a good question. That's actually a good question.
It was on my list, but...
Yeah. I was guessing that. So the thing is that, car sharing works only on a larger scale, because if you have just a few users and many cars, it will lose you a lot of money. So it's very important to define on what scale it should work. And that's also something that we did. So if we have a large customer, if it's a large company, can we make that company profitable? And if it can be profitable, okay, scale it to different companies. But the same for the consumers, because then the scale matters more than with a business customer. Mm-hmm. Then you define your smallest market that you can can
dress.
Yeah. And for us, it was starting off with Eindhoven. Eindhoven is not the largest city in the Netherlands, and especially not in Europe. And what we did, we put enough cars in Eindhoven to provide the service profitable to all the users that can use it inside the city.
Because you need a certain scale. There have to be a few numbers of cars. Yep. You have to get known. It's like how Facebook started. You told me before. Eh? Actually also on campus that you have this, that people know each other.
Yeah, this is the same for us. If we have 250 cars, if we put them all around the Netherlands, then it will probably cost a lot of money. But when we concentrated on different hubs like Eindhoven, Tilburg, and Bos, and our larger customers, then it makes it easier to make it profitable. Facebook started with starting their platform on a university campus. Yeah. So the people that are on Facebook, these are also the people that you know in real life.
Okay.
But if you have thousands of users in the whole of the world, then probably nobody will meet somebody else who is also on Facebook. So then it doesn't work anymore.
So you have to start concentrated, actually, for your service to work in this case. Yeah.
Yeah. And that's also the thing that the scale that you can prove your profitability. So if you can make it work in Eindhoven, just scale it to all the other cities and you will make it profitable.
Okay, but that's an important point. You say scale it to all the other. Are you easy scalable? Is it for you relatively easy to just pick another concentrated city?
Yes, because the cars are mobile. You can place them everywhere, so it's easy to.
Yeah, you don't need any
physical spot or
no cradle or what have you, or specific parking spots for Amber that every now and then you have.
Okay. We don't have to produce it because the car are not produced by ourselves, so that makes it also easier to
not yet.
But if you compare it to software, it's harder because you have to finance these cars, and these cars are quite expensive.
Hardware doesn't scale as easy as software.
Exactly. Yeah. So software is easier, but if you're doing hardware, then a model like this will scale easier than when you have to produce your own product.
Okay, so you have 250 cars at this moment, you said? And growing, or because of the corona?
Yeah, with the corona, we
just paused for a thing.
We paused it, yes, exactly. But after September, that's what we guessing that everything will go forward. Then we will, of course, grow the company. We are not at the scale that we want to achieve. No, definitely not.
Maybe practical question, just for information, because I always like to talk about cars. But the practical thing is that this is electric cars. Huh?
Yep.
That's also because you want to go for sustainable mobility. Yep. So there's no reason you want to have a gasoline car. But the marriage between electrical cars and sharing has a positive side, because the buying an electric car is relatively expensive. So using it is relatively cheap. So use it as much as possible. That actually says you have to share. On the other hand, is that a shared car, you want to refuel it anytime. You have to charge it. If somebody doesn't charge it, the problem is with the next one. And with a gasoline car, it's maybe a 3-minute problem to get it fully charged again. This is something that with shared cars is an extra hassle.
It depends.
How did you solve it that people are behaving a little bit and charge them in the end of their...
Most of our users are very kind and just put them at the charger when they are empty. But you're driving an electric car yourself, so you know that an electric car is never empty, because you charge at every moment that you can charge, and that means that every morning your car is full, because it's charged at home or charged at the street. It doesn't matter, because the car is then always full, so you never have to fuel it. If you do the charging,
but if I don't recharge it, I fool myself. So that's kind of an incentive for myself. And is everybody normally behaving well? Because it might also not that your intention is to charge it, but there's no free charging point, and you're in a hurry, etc. So you just leave it somewhere.
Yeah,
does that happen a lot? How do you solve that?
Now, most of the time, our users are kind and just put them at the charger, and that's nice, but not always. So, but our model is also that we distribute the cars around the city, so we're driving around with these cars the whole day, and these are also the moments that we will put a car at the charger when we are close to the car, or the car needs to be cleaned, then we always put it at the charger. So our software is also arranged around charging the cars as soon as possible. But the whole system is designed for electric cars. I have no idea how to do it with petrol cars. Actually, I have no idea.
Although there's one advantage of quickly refueling, but you don't even pay attention to this kind of different market.
I think you need a card for it to pay it.
Yeah, I can't.
Somebody has to do it, and who has to do it? So I have no idea how to do it operationally.
Cool. And don't start worrying about that because you're thinking about the future. Yeah. Okay, getting back to the financials, the business case.
Yeah.
You're about to raise a lot of money, which you did.
Yeah.
You have to come up with a business case. You have to prove a little bit, but what's the important stuff that happened around that point?
Yeah, the most important thing is that you prove that your business model is working and that you can deliver it. And especially when you're talking to professional investors, not to the friend, family, and fools. They participate in the idea. And
they're either family or fools or friends. So
yeah. And there's a good reason to participate.
But then you said a positive such a businessman that of course has his reasons to.
Yeah. And they are also looking a little bit to the past. So what have you done? Yeah. What kind of customers do you have? How big are they? Are they profitable? How big will the company be? How is the market looking? Is it a growing market? Is it a decaying market?
Scalability will pass then. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. So then you write an investor memorandum. So that's the
investment memorandum.
Yeah. And that's an big PowerPoint, so to say. That explains what you have done, who your customers are, who the team is, and also how the market is growing in the future. And you explain everything about that, and then that gives some the feeling for the investor that you have thought about it, that you know what you're doing, and that you know that you in what direction you are going. And that's an important thing.
Then maybe Hans, within this document, because this question by Samuel from Swegu.com, he's one of the participants in the EIT program, might be on cue. His question is to you: how do you separate profitability, this gross profitability, versus also covering development or sunk cost? And maybe do you finance them differently?
Yeah.
That's his question to you.
Yeah, that's an important thing. Because all investors want to see that your business is profitable, but your business model is profitable. If you want to invest in a new product, if you want to invest in a better platform, if you want to invest in growing to different countries, they all accept that it will cost money. Because that is part of the game, that is part of growing a company if you want to be faster and
so
bigger.
You should pull those away from each other, the business model or the business, two different topics you can talk about.
Yeah, they are in the same model, but of course, if you lose a lot of money on your business model, then it's an issue. If you lose a lot of money on development, it will probably pay off in the future.
Fair enough.
And that's something that you have to separate for that reason.
Thanks. Yeah.
Okay. So these talks, for some reason, I think you look happy when you talk about it. So it was an exciting time in order to go for your first real investment. Is it?
Yeah.
Do you look back on that quite positively, or?
It's interesting that you noticed, but it is for two reasons. The first reason is that you learn a lot, because you learn a lot about how to make a good financial model, how to convince other people to work on the same goal. But another thing, and that's maybe more important, is that you also learn from your own company, because you have to provide them with evidence. You have to prove some things. You have to validate a lot of things that also gives a lot of insight in your own company that you otherwise will ignore or go
on. You thought it's not important, and now they keep on pointing out that apparently it's important. And
So that makes it these investment that so interesting. Yeah.
And these investors are not these evil kind of persons that you always see in the stereotypes.
sometimes there are,
but even from those you will learn, and they.
That's true. That they are not telling you, oh, how great what you're doing, but
they don't spend any time on kissing up. They just
they
immediately come to the point.
They have
a very
useful,
clear and predictable goals.
Yeah, because so you're less time in that sense,
which is refreshing. Yeah.
Yeah.
But don't fear them. You're going to learn, and not so much learn stuff, but learn about your own company, especially. That's an interesting one.
It depends how comfortable you are with your runway. That really depends. So
your runway, you mean?
Your runway. How much money you have left?
Oh yeah.
So that really influences the type of a conversation that you have. If you are if you're nervous for them, then you probably your cash will be burn out in a few weeks, and that's then you have nerves. Yeah,
you were like a running train, building your own tracks and just finding new pieces of track just in time.
And then finally there was this
investment that came that you still run on because you're still running. Okay.
Maybe because Tamur from in the YouTube link has a question adding on that. You already talked about the rough year you had from a business-to-business market going to a business-to-consumer. And I think marketing-wise, you're super clever with the small videos you're putting out. Even you were nominated for Best Entrepreneur Vision recently in the region of Eindhoven. But he goes back to the initial state. So the question by Tamur is, what was your go-to-market strategy even before you met the bank? I mean, how to get the word out? Were there any pilot projects? Some things you mentioned already.
Yeah.
But maybe you can clarify even further.
Yes, because you learn where your market is just by trying a lot. So that's something that's very important. So you have a big goal and you find a lot of ways to come there. So you have a lot of...
What were things you tried?
Detours that you...
What things you thought, I'd rather not. Maybe.
Yeah. What all did you try? What of that did you regret? Yeah.
That's interesting.
As far as you can disclose.
Yeah, of course. But what I'm thinking of was that we started with building a car. That's a very important thing. Then we thought, okay, but autonomous will be the future because otherwise it will be too expensive to distribute the cars all day to all the users.
Oh, so they had guaranteed access by just driving themselves.
Yeah,
to the
exactly.
Point B,
so,
yeah.
So that's something that we spend a lot of time on to validate how can that model work. Uh-huh. Another thing is the intelligence of your software, and that's something that we still use. That's something that we now know that it's very important, but we also gone too far in that direction just by trying to make the system more intelligent to make the model work better than the competitors.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
And then you find a few things from all these different aspects. Okay, this is important. Because what we learned from the autonomous things that we did, that the cars that were more autonomous had less damages. Because the systems that prevent cars from crashing also works in your operations because they prevent also a lot of cars that has taken out of the system to be repaired.
So that's double profit. If you can keep them operational, you don't have the damages.
Yeah. So these are the things that you learn on the way, but that's how you find your place in the...
Are you still investing in trying to get your valet parking stuff, so the way that the car drives in front of you? Is that still on your wish list and development list at this moment?
No, we have developed it till a part that we say, okay, we know what it can do for us, but now we have to wait for other companies to bring on the next generation technology so we can implement it into our system and roll it out. So that's something that we are now. Yeah.
And maybe as well how you put out the word, because now you were this valet parker I saw in a small little ad from some months ago that the car is being delivered at your door, ready when you are, is one of the slogans. But maybe if I can be as free as I can, with adding to that, recently someone asked me what was the best pitch you ever heard, and I didn't come up with an answer, but just recently in the preparation actually for this interview, I thought it was actually one of the pitches done by Amber, by one of your colleagues, Stephen, a few years ago. He was pitching for the province, all of these bold, gray, former men, and they were saying, he started out his pitch with asking who views got a car, owning a car, and all of them were like looking to
who
each other.
Who came here today with a car? Yeah,
that's it. That was the pitch you're using. And who understands and knows that this very expensive machine you're owning sits on his ass for 23 hours a day because you only use it 1 hour a day? And the atmosphere in the room totally swept. Everyone was like baffled, and they thought, okay, what is this guy coming to tell us? So he had full attention.
Yeah.
So I think in the cheekiness on how you delivered your message, that's one of the aspects of Amber as well.
Yeah, and that's also very important that you don't make a story because that's marketing-wise a good idea, but That's something that we really believe in. That's something that we all work on every day to prevent cars from standing still.
Yeah.
And it worked because the province is now a customer of us, so that's a good thing.
Cool. Yeah, awesome.
Yeah. Wait.
Yeah, maybe this is a good moment to once more clarify for the people who are in the exclusive Boost program. Whenever you have a question, we are also open these last 20 minutes to have your question right here on the screen. Yeah. So if you want to give it a go, give us a sign and we will involve you here.
Yeah, and all the other ones on YouTube. Also, keep on the questions coming. Maybe we also go to the second part. If you see the public and private investments, that's also a part that we want to discuss today. Yeah. And we already talked about the province, which is public, but you see them as a customer. That's actually a contract that you have
with
them.
It's always better than investment. Customers are way better than investors, always.
Investors, like especially public investors
investors, because you're selling a part of your company, you can better sell your products, because then so it's better to sell products than
focus
to sell
at least
part
on that one as much as you appreciate your investors. Customers come first, and that's also what your investors probably want you to focus on,
and only raise the money that you really need to deliver more products.
But did you also reach out for public money?
Yeah, especially in the beginning when we did a lot of technical development, just to build a platform, to start with a platform and making all the innovation on it. But a subsidy is a grant is never free money. So it's always making your development cheaper, but not free, but always a bit cheaper, and so you can develop more. So that's where you need the grants for the subsidies. But it's also very you need to be careful with public money, because it's make you flow away from your customers, from the reason why you're doing it. You need to invest in deliver something to the people that need your product, and not somebody who paid you to develop something. That's a very important difference you have to make.
On the other hand, I can imagine some reasons why the public would also be able to invest or would be willing to invest in you. Of course, we have the business investors like the BOM, etc., that wants to see more companies flourish, especially with such a nice future as you have. But on the other hand, you also improve mobility, and we massively subsidize public transport, for instance, with a reason, because it improves city quality and more capacity, etc., less parking stuff. I can think of a few arguments that you also would have the right to raise some public money on that area, but it's not really your focus then?
We work together with a lot of governments, and they are providing us with some help and more on the practical side to deliver our model, but they are not the ones who are funding the company. But one of our investors is a public investor, and they behave like a normal investor, but they are publicly funded.
Okay.
And also one of the important reasons why they are investing is, of course, because we are delivering something for the community. We're delivering a product that makes cities better. So that really helps, of course.
Okay. Three.
Yeah,
questions.
Definitely from some of the participants. So whenever you're ready, we have both Rick and as well Samuel, and maybe we can do them in that order. Rick, you're from Karen, if I'm right. Please show yourself by popping on your video screen and also unmuting yourself.
Here we go.
And
that
I guess
works.
It's not the American Karen, because that's a typification for a certain woman. Maybe you can explain. How do we pronounce it? Karin?
In Dutch, we say Karin.
Ah, there you go. Rick, take it away. You've got a question involving profitability, scalability. Go ahead.
Yeah, thank you. Right now we are developing a mass app in Twente. And I was wondering, because there is obviously a business case in offering your services in urban areas, but do you also see a business case in offering the services in rural areas? Why not?
Thank you.
That's an interesting question, and that's something that we also thought about a lot. We know that our model works also in lower density areas than the biggest cities in Europe. If you look to the competitors in Amsterdam, they have different way of distributing the cars because they are probably in front of your door. That is how the model works. So there are a lot of cars in the city, but it's also always in front of a lot of doors. So they need a higher density to make their model work. And we are distributing the cars, and that makes the model also work in lower density.
You mean distributing a car that you bring the car from B to C?
Exactly.
Somebody else drives from A to B and you bring it from B to C?
Yeah, so our valet service that we bring the car in front of you works in a lower density area than just the larger cities. But what we also know, there is a limit to that, because if you have rural areas, for most of the people, it's probably for a long time more profitable or cheaper to have their own car. Yeah, in the end for the community. The same counts for trains. There are a lot of the trains that are driving in the urban areas. They are probably profitable, but they lose all the money on the trains that are driving in the rural areas.
You're actually about to adopt an own train, isn't it? You would like to own a train, isn't it?
I like to own a train.
So, because you're very fond of trains, isn't it?
I like any mode of transport, but owning is another thing.
I'll rather do the royal family.
Trains is a fantastic thing to share, actually. Yeah. And leave them to the NS, who does a very good job in owning them.
I'm just joking, but previous time you spoke about multiple cars and everything. Yeah, this answers your question, Rick. Does it?
Yes, it does.
Excellent.
Thank you very much.
But can I hook on to that? Because you say that's a different model. I can understand that. But somebody drives with a number from A to B. Somebody else uses it to drive from C to D. You bring it from B to C.
Yeah.
Who's doing that, and how do you go to B and then go back from D? Is that with a little
we have folding
kickstep or something?
Yeah, we have a lot of students from the university, but also in all
the
cities.
Students to do that.
Yeah, and they have a folding bike in the back of the car and just drive to the next car and put it on the charger, cleans it, but also brings it to the right location.
That's an interesting one. Yeah.
Still looking for a side job? The weather is becoming better.
I could imagine as a student I would like to do that.
Yeah, but it's a nice job to do. So
And it tackles another thing, is that what also actually was kind of lethal to the Paris Autoliv project is that they get very dirty at a certain moment if you do not regularly clean them or at least check on them.
Yeah.
And this gives also a little bit of social pressure to leave it behind in a good manner.
Yeah, that's something that we've learned, is that cars that are dirty will become more dirty.
That's
always
it's
how
an
it
excuse
works.
To even leave more garbage in it, etc.
Yeah, exactly.
So yes, that's an extra example. I understand. Okay,
Samuel is there on the screen. Yeah. We recognize you from previous session. Yes. Excellent for you to join again. Take it away.
Good to see you.
It's a great opportunity to ask questions. So thank you very much, and thank you for the already very interesting session. My question is related to let's say your balance sheet and how you deal with the lease part and let's say the operational part.
Yeah.
If you look now, you initially wanted to build your own car. Okay, you decide not to do that. You decide to lease. How much are you modifying that existing car, and what kind of challenges does that bring in terms of you not just leasing a standard car?
Yeah.
We're looking at something similar. So we're trying to electrify existing bikes via a lease model. So we will own all of the electronic, let's say the intelligent components of the e-bike.
Mm-hmm.
But we're trying to figure out a way, what is intelligent or what's a smart way of funding the CapEx, which will be partially designed by us or modified existing components. So how did you convince lease companies to finance modified CapEx or assets?
Yeah, that is an important thing, because we use the car for 4 years, around that period. And after that, they just go back to the market. And one of the things is the modification. So we don't order cars with orange roofs. We sticker them, because otherwise they can't be resold anymore. Another thing is that all our telematics, so the hardware that connects to our app and that it works as a shared car,
Because you don't need a key, huh? No. You open it with an app that requires an adaptation.
On the screen here. So it is.
Here we go.
Yeah. So please download the app. You can use it yourself.
So you open it with an app. So you have to do something with the locking, etc., to adapt it.
Yeah. So we have a special hardware in the car built in to control the locks but also that we can track it when we don't. So we know where the car is when somebody left it somewhere. That's something that needs to be done, and we can also control the car from our office. And so that's something that's very important, but that is something that needs to be put out when you remark the cars, because the other users don't have anything with it to do with our software. So that's something that needs to be removed. But the other very important thing, especially for cars, is we need a certain variety in the type of cars and the color of the cars that we are using, because otherwise when we put the cars back into the market and the market will be crowded with white BMW i3s, the price of the i3 will go down. And in the end, we will always pay the bill for that. So that's that's also something that needs to be into account. So don't spoil the market with your successful model. That's something that's very important. Yeah.
Okay. Are you looking to other? But based on the assets, you have to keep the assets low. You do lease always, although you have to adapt the thing. It's not your car.
It's never a car. No.
You keep as lean as possible, because that's. You're very lean, I can say.
Yeah, and that's very important for a company, that you can change when you have an.
Does this clarify your question, Samuel? Does it clarify? Is it answering your question?
Definitely, very helpful. Yeah. So basically, all of the modifications you have done are really easy to.
I didn't mention easy, but it is removable, yes, of course.
But why don't you keep them for 8 years then, and instead of 4 years? Thanks, you don't have to remove it. It's an electric car. It's a very well-built electric car, the i3. Yeah. So can't you do them with 4 8 years? So use them a little longer than four?
Probably we can, but when the maintenance of the car goes up, then our operational costs will skyrocket. So
as an electrical car, they don't require maintenance, do they? But they're used a lot, of course.
Yeah, exactly. There's a trade-off on that, and that's also something that you pay in the end. So that's
It's probably widening up compared to gasoline cars, because they do less maintenance, but it's still.
Yeah, this is also an example from rental companies, because they use the car for a shorter period of time, because they always sell the car at the highest residual value of the car. So they optimize that, and sometimes it means that the car is just used for half a year or 1 year till it will be replaced, because it's cheaper, because the remarketing value is higher of the car. So there's a trade-off there.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Maybe on this, we touch again something that we also touched on in the first episode, maybe to just get your opinion on that one. That was about strategic partnerships. And we then highlighted the big difference between Lightyear and, for instance, another scale-up Tesla. Mm-hmm. Tesla decides to do everything themselves, which costs them a lot of money, and which is a very risky path that they somehow are quite successfully doing. Where Lightyear says, now everything that somebody else can do better, we let do somebody else, so that we can focus on actually the point that we want to focus on and keep lean, etc. Yes, you have less control, you're more dependent on other ones, especially if you're only one supplier. We know all the negative stuff, but otherwise there will never be a Lightyear car, and I ordered one, so I hope they stick to that. What's your position in this? Are you doing? Do you also pick on the things that you do specialize and keep that for yourself, and the rest is all for other ones? Or
there are a lot of things that you can outsource, but some of the things you don't want to outsource, especially in the beginning. For example, your customer support. Your customer service, that's something that you, especially in the beginning, want to have in-house, because you get all the feedback from the users directly, and you can implement features and see what the feedback is, and you can develop together with your
customers. So you have customer support 5-6 people 24/7?
You
have 24/7 customer support.
Not the office, but we have people that are taking the phone from home.
Yeah, at least. Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah.
So that's one, customer service. Probably your app, et cetera, and the software.
Yeah, development. So that's something that we do in-house, because our product is the app. Our product is the software that provides the sharing and makes our model viable. That's something that we need to do ourselves, because that's something that we need to be good at.
Cool.
Yeah.
Okay.
So you want that IP yourself. You also want to have...
You have IP on your software, etc.
Everything you develop has IP.
Oh, yeah, and it's also...
But software is difficult to patent, so that's something else. Okay, it's a different topic.
That's probably another episode.
Yeah, exactly.
So stick to the episodes.
Yeah,
but, okay.
Yeah, but that's something, if you are focused on a certain subject or something that you need to be good at, please do it yourself. And everything else, accepting the things that are close to the users, you need to have it in-house, but for the rest, please, as much as possible.
Yeah. No, I worked for TomTom a long time, and they had customer service, R&D, and branding as the three things, and all the other ones they tried to left to each other, which made them quite successful, and also
it's a good strategy. Yeah.
Able to change from business to consumer to business, still going strong, fantastic company, but also
but for the rest,
very similar focus.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. You have another question?
Looking at the clock, we only have like a few minutes left, so maybe it's nearly time for some wrap-up. There's still another question in the YouTube live stream.
Let's do that one then as a closure. Yeah.
Well, this is like it's going high over, maybe a concise, small answer is possible, because you're a car fanatic since you were very young.
Yeah.
You've participating in so many eco-marathons to come up with the most sustainable car. You initiated Ecomotive Car here as a student startup, but... One of the viewers is asking, Hans, how do you think about a car as a status object?
Uh-huh.
And that's the point that...
Owning the car, being successful.
And I can confirm that, because I also a car enthusiastic. So, but the thing is...
You rather have 250, which you every now and then...
You're a car, he has 250 cars.
Yes, so we're doing well. So.
No, but so this car has a status.
Yeah, and that's exactly the point when our product isn't for everybody. And that's also something that for every startup is very important. Who is your user? Who is the who are the people that are really want to use it and make it perfect for them and not for everybody? Because that will definitely ruin your company.
Excellent.
But dreaming of car status disappearing and nobody wants a car anymore and all, that's not going to happen. But I'm a user, and you thought about my car when you came in, so that's probably not.
But
still, then Amber is a very nice add-up to that one. Also for Uber drivers, they don't get rid of their car, but they still use Uber. So there's room for growth even beyond.
And Hans,
of course, in the end, but that is very important for your company. Okay. Don't focus on everybody outside, because that's not...
That's exactly.
You don't and you that. Reframe it entirely when you open the app. It's not about saying, I want a BMW, want a new Tesla, but I want to Amber.
Yeah, exactly.
That's actually what you want to get in between the ears.
The nice thing about mobility, and that's also for all startups that are in the area of mobility, people in every country spend about 13-15% of their budget to mobility, everything. Cars become cheaper, also because of electricity, etc. So we have cheaper cars. That leaves more room for services. And this is the kind of service that increases your value. It can also be flying or taking train, etc. But these are the kind of services.
Yeah.
And a few percent of people's budget is a few percent of the world's gross domestic product. And that's quite
a lot
in order to win. So I wish you good luck. Maybe a few things that I at least wrote down from you. The triple F. So if you're a startup, you want to go for money, start with the triple F. Friends, family, and fools. That can also be combined in one person, maybe. But anyhow, go look for them. Think about the ABC, this big, hairy, audacious goal, this very big goal that you started with by building your own autonomous cars, etc. And then also trying to have a sharing model. You ended with the sharing model that you ever that you otherwise would have never found. So stick to your goal, go there, and look what you found on the way. It might be the end goal, but there's a lot of other stuff in order to discover as well. Don't fear big companies too much.
Yeah.
Also don't fear the investments, because they make you learn about your product and yourself and all kind of stuff, and they're rather predictable people, which also helps. And there's no such thing as a free subsidized service, so look for public money, but it's not to make your life easier. It's to just push you in the right direction. That's actually what you should do with that. So with that, I thank you a lot.
Thank you.
Nice to see you every now and then, we keep crossing roads, etc. And I hope that continues for another few decades. So good luck with everything you're doing. I want to thank you for listening. Before I give the word back to Rudy, also check on the EIT Urban Mobility website, because a lot of other interesting stuff around this mobility is happening, and this boost session is at least one of them. Second, when we are going to go back in a month from now with the third second.
I guess that's with Christoph from EVBox.
Yep.
And if they want to learn more, obviously they can visit the site, driveamber.com, or just simply download the app.
Yeah.
As we've seen, download the app. That's a call to action from you, Hans. So much thank you for joining. For all the viewers, I don't know, where's the camera? Right there. Excellent. In the YouTube live stream, thank you so much for watching and also contributing with all of your questions. Maybe you see later on. This is the second one in the series of four. So in about 4 weeks' time, we will be back with our third interview, isn't it, Carlo? That will be awesome. And for the handpicked people in the Boost program in the Microsoft Teams account right now, hang around for some more 5 minutes, because maybe we could do a super short after talks here with Carlo and Hans as well. Thanks for joining, and hope to see you next time.